Are you ready to bring your subtitling skills to the next level? Then stay until the end of this video as I unfold the solutions to the most annoying and complicated problems you will face when subtitling. As you might imagine, subtitling is not as easy as that, and you will probably find yourself dealing with a number of obstacles, and the process won't always be smooth. But don't worry, because I've been there, done that, and I'm here to make your life easier and give you all the tips you need. The first scenario is also the most recurring one, and it's the overlapping talk. What should we do when two people speak at the same time?
They didn't have that.
No, they didn't. No. But then at the end they did.
And it was.
First of all, you should focus on one person at a time to make sure you pick up every word and transcribe it correctly. Once you got it, you need to separate the two lines. You can either use a dash or specify the name of the speaker. I usually opt for the first solution, whereas I'd go for option number two in case it's hard to tell who's talking. But either way, make sure to be consistent and use the same technique throughout the whole video. When subtitling for the deaf and hard of hearing, you should either use a caller for each person or specify the name of the speaker. Text messages, billboards, road signs, should we always translate them? Well, the answer is, it depends. If they're relevant to the video and they give essential information, then yes. But if it's in the background, it's blurred and has no particular meaning and adds nothing to the video, then no, you don't have to. If someone's speaking at the same time, meaning that the bottom part of the screen is already taken, the sign or text can be moved to a different part of the screen where it will bother as little as possible, but we'll see that in a bit. If the person isn't in frame, then just switch to italic. It's the most common solution every subtitler uses, and also we use it when the voice is somehow distorted by a telephone, a microphone, a loudspeaker, and so on. If you watch subtitled content, I bet you already noticed the way we caption noises. It needs to be a concise textual representation of the audio, and it's put in lowercase inside square brackets. Here are several sound effects, music and noises captions that you've probably seen in TV shows and movies. And what if the sound you need to caption is not among these ones? Well, just be creative and find the best solution to describe what you're hearing with a few words. If a famous song is playing in the background, just type the title and the artist in brackets. On the contrary, if the sound is relevant and there's actually someone singing it, then you can caption the lyrics, and you do that by putting them between two S keys or musical notes. Swear words seem to be a concerning topic for lots of people because it might seem inappropriate to caption them. But to be honest, the truth is, it's not really up to us. It depends a lot on who's commissioning the work and their guidelines, but also on the context. But for example, if we are subtitling a TV show where that specific character is known to be loud and rough spoken, and that's a distinctive feature of his, then who are we to change it? If you're subtitling a TV show, a movie, or a documentary, it's very likely that you'll have to deal with credits. These are usually positioned in the bottom part of the screen, which is where the subtitles are as well. So what can you do about that? Well, in this case, you're entitled to make an exception and move the subtitles in a different part of the screen, which won't bother the scene too much. As for visual subsync, you can do that by adding a sort of tag to the line, and each number from 1 to 9 will position the subtitles in a specific part of the screen. My former students also talked to me about their struggles when subtitling, so here are a couple of extra points. But before we move on, make sure to like this video and also subscribe to my channel so you won't miss any upcoming videos. Let's say the person speaks really fast and takes no breaks.
My brain is a wild jungle full of scary gibberish. I'm writing a letter. I can't write a letter. Why can't I write a letter? I'm wearing a green dress. I wish I was wearing my blue dress.
This will make it really hard to understand how to split the whole thing into multiple subtitles. The number one criterion is to respect the time limits and characters per line, but also while having a sense of fulfillment in each subtitles, so the viewers won't struggle to tag along and understand the meaning of the whole dialogue. If you realize a repartee is super quick and you want to merge the two subtitles into one, there's a nice and easy way of doing it. You select both lines, right-click, merge into dialogue. Ta-da! Okay, last one, number 10. Let's say you're subtitling a video of a traveler who's in Vietnam and talks to local people, but you can't quite pick up their first name. You make some research, but nothing. So you initially spell it one way. Then halfway through the video, you manage to get it, or maybe the YouTuber writes the name on the screen. Well, how can you change all those misspelled names in one simple click? Just click on Edit, Find, Replace All. There you go, guys, these were my 10 top tips to level up your subtitling skills. Feel free to comment down below if there's anything you struggle with but I haven't mentioned so I can help you out, and I will see you soon.